Thank you, Jocelyn. My name is Lori Gravish Hertek, and I'm on the kinesiology faculty at Penn State University. I'm an assistant teaching professor, and I also do internship coordination. And in the last 3 years, I've taken on another role of alumni development within our department as well, which I'll talk about, which will give you another facet of how you steer some of these trips or coordinate this as a learning model for course curriculum. A few notes before we get started. One, if you stay to the end, looking at the numbers in the room, you'll probably get a treat. So if you're looking for something free, please stick around. I like to save the video for the very end, because if I show you the video first, you're like, oh, okay, I got enough information, and you'll take off. But I have a student from 2 years ago that put together a very educationally sound video on what we do here at Penn State for this course curriculum. So I think it'll really sell a great point for you as you leave here today. I must first note that I want to make a disclaimer. We're not here to brag about what we do at Penn State, about this course curriculum. We just want to provide evidence of what has worked in the past and where you should start. And I think one of the learning take-home messages should be, you want to start small. You just want to start with 4 students, and that will blossom from there. I don't want you to leave here thinking you need to develop an entire course curriculum and you're taking it to administrators. I will take you through a step-by-step process of what we've done over the years, what has been worked, what was troubleshooted in the past. I would also like to thank some people before I even start this presentation, because without those individuals, we would not be allowed to do what we do here at Penn State. I want to first thank our department head of kinesiology, Dr. Nancy Williams, who believes in providing our undergraduates a very enriching opportunity for experiential learning and professional development. I would like to thank the dean of our college. Our former dean just left, Dean Nan Crowder, but we have a new dean, Dean Craig Neuschafer, who is also on board with some of our initiatives. And conferences and institutes at Penn State University is who we offer this course through. So they do a lot to make sure that we have the reservations for the hotel and different things within an operational budget. I do have 2 colleagues in the room that also I work with. I co-teach this course with Michelle Duffy, who is also in the audience, is an assistant teaching professor in our Department of Kinesiology. And we also have Dr. Christopher Bopp, who also teaches in our department and also does some outreach events here at the summit as well. So I want to thank those individuals for their support. I wanted to start with a few photos to make you understand a little bit about why students come to the summit. Like, what makes them spend the money to actually be here? Because if you think about it, I mean, just ballpark it, it could possibly cost a student about $1,000 when it's all said and done. So I'm going to give you some ways and ideas and tips along this journey this morning of how they can offset their cost for them to want to participate with you. So this is a trip from Reno 2003. This was not our first trip, but this, looking back in the archive photos, this is some of the first ones I could find. So it took about a month for me to find all of this archival information. But I asked some students this morning, why are you here? Why did you come to the summit? What did you like best? And one student said, we just love to travel. We're just excited to go to a new city. And we're excited to meet people. We love the workouts. We love the vendors. And, you know, just even with expositions, when I'm in a teaching classroom, and I know my colleagues that attend this same session, we can say to students, do you know Zumba? And they'll say, yeah, Zumba. I'll say, for us, that was 8 years ago. Do you know Propel Vitamin Water? Yes, that was 12 years ago. So when you come to the ACSM Summit, you are getting cutting-edge technology sometimes a year or 2 years before it's even hit the East Coast market, which is nice. So this was our first group of students. And in the very infancy stage of this development, this was not a course. This was just me bringing students to the summit, and I'll talk about where I generated that idea. But we usually, at the beginning, we traveled together on this journey. Another reason students like to attend the summit is they love to see the keynote speakers, a big celebrity name. You know, Lynn Swan was in Reno. I don't know how many students were super stoked to say Reno is top on their list, but I can tell you this, when I mentioned to students, you know, I'm going to develop another piece of the you know, the curriculum here, how about we schedule a day visit to Lake Tahoe? So back in the day, back in 2003, it was very cheap. We could rent a charter bus. It was through a chartered company, and they picked us up at the hotel. They took us to this little like western ghost town for an hour, and then we drove through the Sahara Nevadas, and then we had a lunch cruise, included the lunch and the cruise on Lake Tahoe, and then we went to Squaw Valley, home of the number 1964 Winter Olympics, and then they drove us home. That cost $54 per student. Every student said, I'm in, I want to do this. So that was another enticing piece where students said they got a little bit out of it. So when we returned from that day's activity, we got to see Lynn Swan, and some of those students today I'm still communicating with. Actually, the girl in the striped shirt, Stacy Krupski, was a former student of ours. She's been to the summit ever since, and she's on our faculty. So she's been here 19 straight years. This was the dinner boat cruise. So again, it's about opportunities. It's a little bit of extra time to see cities here in Chicago, if they get their photo by the Bean, if they want to go up the Willits Tower, and they, you know, it's just that extra piece of bragging rights that they're here, they can tag it with social media. Our students love to be branded in Penn State Apparel. And I think that when I thought of this idea back in the day, the ultimate goal in our university is you're trying to attract students to understand the importance of your curriculum. Like, why is Penn State Kinesiology a better curriculum than another university that offers something similar? So for us, we like to, you know, any institution would like to profess, we provide the best in this resource because of these three reasons. So for our students, we like to say, we offer these experiential learning opportunities for professional development. We don't discriminate against any students outside of kinesiology. So if students in nutrition want to go, if students in biobehavioral health, somebody, one year we had a student in communications and advertising and also in writing English as a second language, wanted to come to this conference, students in electrical engineering. As long as they have a passion about exercise, fitness, medicine, cutting edge technology, then we want to bring them to the summit. And Chris Clark, she's a retired faculty member in nutrition, and she was one of the leading sports nutritionists in the country. So our students at the end of every session, if we find a Penn Stater like Catherine Schmitz, we invited her to our dinner the other night so that the students could meet some of our Penn State people. So there's Chris Clark, and if you see to the left there in the blue, that's Laura Kruskal, Dr. Laura Kruskal. She's a graduate of ours. Every year that she comes to the summit, she'll call and say, hey, are you having a student engagement? I want to come to the dinner. I want to talk to students. She will stay for 4 hours post-dinner and talk to every student and give advice, give networking opportunities, anything related to internships. These are two students that attended the summit back in the day. That's Mark Werner and Rainey Dole. Rainey was a biobehavioral health student. She's now a physician assistant. Mark was a student of ours. He is now a practitioner nurse. They're both married. They met on the trip. They eventually got together. They're married and they have 4 kids. And they talk about this all the time. So anytime I post social media, they're like, that's where we met. This is our first, you know, everybody gets excited about it. Of course, Orlando is always a big draw because you got amusement parks, Disney, Harry Potter land. Again, we talk about speakers. Sometimes it's a keynote address speaker. Dot Richardson with the Olympics softball allowed every person after a presentation 1 year to put on the medal. And people were excited. And that boy, Matt Becker from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, still talks about having the medal around his neck, which was awesome. And you can see Karen Pierce from ACSM in the background as well. Mary Saunders, students love workouts. So Mary Saunders is I consider her the number one guru in the world on aquatics. I know she's offering presentations while she's here today. But in the upper right-hand corner, you'll see some students there. They're all Penn Staters. And what I want you to get out of this is you don't necessarily need to think, okay, this is a kinesiology student that wants to only open their own gym. The gentleman there to the right, he is a surgeon. The gentleman to his left is now a chiropractor. The girl next to him, she's an occupational therapist, and the girl behind is a physician assistant. So they've taken pieces of what they've learned here at the conference and applied it to their course curriculum for graduate school and or their professional development. So the purpose of today is to provide that insight of facilitation of how you could develop this into a curriculum. So it's this piece by piece representation. So over the past 18 years, we've provided, and I've counted this because I keep documented statistics on this, we have brought over 556 Penn State undergraduates to the ACSM Health and Fitness Summit. That averages about 30 a year. And pretty much Michelle and I wouldn't want to say knock on wood, but we have it down to a science where we know exactly what time of the year we need to start talking about it. Once we leave here, because of which I'll talk about a little bit later about what they're doing in the course, that is a marketing tool that just kind of spreads and you can just stand back. So when I talk about certain years where we had 75 and 78 students back-to-back years, we did not need to advertise for that at all. Like, we didn't need to beg people and say, please show up. It was, oh, we have 75 people. We might need to bring a third faculty member on board to help manage this. So how this really started for me was I attended the ACSM Health and Fitness Summit, the very second one, which was in Las Vegas. It was at the Paris Hotel. And I was working for two companies at the time. I was working for Penn State University and also a private physical therapy cardiac rehabilitation facility. So I did not have any person paying my bill other than myself to say, I want to go to this summit. So I'm walking down the Paris Hotel where they have the little shops, and I see three students in Michigan State t-shirts. Not one, not two, but three. And I thought, what? Like, there's three Michigan State t-shirts. I'm the only Penn State representative here. So I went back to my department head. At the time, he was the interim department head, and I said, I just got back from the most cutting-edge technology ACSM conference I've ever attended. I've attended the national ones in May, but I wanted more applicable hands-on learning, workshop design, group workout, pearls of wisdom from the best guru exercise fitness professionals in the globe. Can we take students to this event? Could I steer that? And if I do that, would you pay my flight and my hotel to be able to do that? And the gentleman at the time, Dr. Scott Kretschmar, said, yeah, of course, yeah, we'd do that. Well, I instantly left his office and started marketing for the event. And so I was in classroom settings, showing some photos, who would be interested in going on a trip, and we started very basic. It was very basic at that time. But when students know that they can come to a conference and not only get information that's useful for their future, but meet the people that have written the books, or you get to do a workout with Lawrence Biscottini, who is my all-time favorite exercise expert in the world. I follow him every day on social media. To know you get to do that workout once a year, that's a special moment. That's something that not everyone gets the opportunity to afford. So I just put that thought into practice. Like I said, I just asked the department head, would you be willing to offer this? And simply ask a question. And I want to note at the bottom of this slide that in its early infancy stage, this was not a course-driven event. This was just a faculty leader saying, I want to steer this ship, and who would like to go? And let's have a sign-up sheet. And then we'll have an informational meeting and talk about the cost and how we're going to put it all together. So for the 3 years in a row that I offered it by myself, these were the three conference venue sites. So Orlando, we had 14 that very first year. The next year it went up to 19, and then it started gravitating and it doubled within the first year to 28. And a faculty member approached me, who is senior faculty, and said, do you know that, I'd like to be on board with you and turn this into a course. And I said, we could do that? I didn't know that was possible. He said, yes, I've done it in other courses here at the university. So Dr. Bob Ricketts approached me and said, let's get some course curriculum design. we put together a syllabus, the whole nine yards, and I'll have a slide on that of what we did, how we went through that whole process. But the numbers just really grew, and it wasn't something that I was trying to go beg people to do. I would just simply speak in my classes or go speak to the kinesiology club and say, who would possibly be interested? And then you just go from there. When we did then switch over to it being developed into a course curriculum, from 2005 now to 2019 for 15 consecutive years, it's now a credit-based driven course. So students receive two credits in the Department of Kinesiology. These two credits, now again, every university could be different, but for our university and to get it to pass within curriculum, it is a two-credit pass-fail course. And in order to pass the course, you must maintain an 85% in the course to pass. So they do not receive an A, B, C, or D, but they receive a pass-fail. And I can tell you this, we've had students that have attended as early as their freshman year, and they've gone all 4 years in a row. We have a student on this trip now, she's a junior, and she's already said, I'm in for next year, like count me in, I have to finish this strong. Why? Because she wants to go into the fitness industry, she wants to go big time someday, and she wants to learn from the very best. These were our highest student enrollments. Typically it's anything out west. Why? Because people on the East Coast, our students maybe have never gone out there, and this is why they want to do it. And so Long Beach, California, that was the year when Dr. Bob Rickett said, you know, we need a third faculty member. We brought Michelle Duffy on board for this, and 78 students. It's just the way it happened. It just was very organic in nature. And then Vegas, if you remember the Vegas, we did Vegas back-to-back years. We had 75 each time, without a doubt. But again, understand that a good majority of those students were seniors, so as they sloughed off, they went back, and other students said, I heard about that trip. I wish I would have done this trip sooner, and there's another 75 on board. So I ask you, why would your academic institution be in favor of a curriculum model for the future? Well, at Penn State University, we have different pillars at which our university operates by at Old Main. And one of those areas in our strategic plan basically focuses on student engagement. I know our president of our university strongly would like every student to have an international travel before they graduate. Now, that's not always possible, but they really try to provide opportunities, scholarships to be able to make that happen for those students that are really engaged and want the chance to do that. So student engagement is huge for us. And then just the university presence. I know at our national meeting every year, I don't know the exact number, but I'm gonna say at least, would you say 20 kinesiology faculty members in our department are always presenting their research. And so they're always branded well at that conference, and so we're branded well at this conference as well. And we think of it like a marrying, we try to marry the relationship. So for Penn State, or I speak on behalf of Michelle Duffy and I, we try to find an organization that's gold standard. It's something that we believe in, something the university would back from that standpoint, and something that students would believe in. Because why? At the end of the day, parents are going to give the money to their children to say, why should we send you to this conference? And we want to be branded with the best of the best. And we believe that the American College of Sports Medicine is that national organization, and the ACSM Health and Fitness Summit is that vehicle which we can tap into for our students to grow and prosper. And the third area is financial resourcing. If you were to turn this course into, if you were to bring students and eventually down the road turn this into a course curriculum, this could generate revenue for your department, and I'm not saying that's the number one reason why you would do it, but it would develop an operational budget. So if you've ever seen our students here at the conference, like today, outside of the keynote, there was bagels and coffee and people sitting in a little circle. That's because we had the financial support in our budget to be able to offset a few extra little things for our students along the way, which is nice. Or sometimes we go to our department head, and this year was the first year our department head, we said we're only one plane ride away. It's a direct flight from State College. We really implore that you go to this trip and really see it. You've heard about it your whole life, but I want you to see the camaraderie that we bring and our presence. And Dr. Nancy Williams attended and was highly impressed. Plus, she had the opportunity to work with such a close-knit group. She got to learn in the process as well. So I then, you know, can say, Dr. Williams, do you think we have a little bit of extra funding to buy the students bagels and coffee? Yes, I think we could do that. So we can tap into sometimes a little side budget. So why would you want to devote your time and effort to even consider this as a possibility? One, you're not here today if it wasn't cutting edge. You're not going to waste your time, your money, your employer's money. You're here because you believe in it. You're branded to it. Second of all, it's always about professional growth. Somebody always knows more than you do, and at the end of the day, your goal is to always present the most updated information to your students. Thirdly, you want to understand that you're here from your academic standpoint of your institution. If you have a shirt on and you're wearing it proud, loud and proud, Michigan State, whether it's University of Florida Gators, people see that and they say Indiana. You're like, yeah, that's right. We want to give a little branding. People will navigate to you in the hallway and say, oh my God, my cousin went to Indiana. It's now a conversation. That starts a networking piece, and that's huge. Some of our students in the past, and I can tell you in the 18 years, they network here for jobs, internships, graduate school opportunities. When we were in Phoenix, Arizona, a few years back, two students decided to go visit a grad school along the way and said, we're applying, and they did, and they're in Phoenix right now. And some students get jobs, interviews, graduate opportunities. They know that they're very well sound and set based on the curriculum that we provide that I'll show you in a few minutes. And possibly for you, that's lit up there in pink, it could mean a free trip for you. So if you steer that, your department head may say, sometimes departments are different, they may say you can go to a conference every other year, or they may say all we're willing to give you is $500, whatever it is, but maybe now that it turns into a course trip or a curriculum, you're now able to ask for a little bit more support and funding, not only from your department, but possibly from the college as well. And if you do turn this into course development, again, it could provide you supplemental income, because if you're the professor in charge or you co-direct, you then receive a supplemental honorarium for directing that. Now, please understand, Michelle Duffy and I's role is not just we attend the ACSM summit and then we walk away. This is like planning for a wedding all year long, just getting the steps in place and making sure. Students kind of just show up and say, this is great. But we're the behind-the-scenes people to navigate those little things that the idiosyncrasies that take place last minute. Like one year we were in Austin, Texas, and we were there till Sunday, and everybody's room key would not work on Saturday. Students get freaked out. It's like, okay, it's relaxed. All is well in the world. Let's meet up for a pretzel. It's all good. And then we have undergraduate engaging opportunities. So for us, when our students leave here, now, granted, in our Department of Kinesiology, we have over 680 undergraduate majors in kinesiology. We used to have close to 1,000, but a new major popped up and kind of taken a few from us, which is okay, that's fine. But out of the 680 students, some of the people that are here with us from Penn State that are part of our course curriculum, they've seen students in the classroom to say, oh yeah, I recognized her. But while they're on this trip, they turn into a little family. And I can tell you this, when they go back Sunday, Monday, they're already texting these people saying, oh my God, I miss you already. This was a great trip. But we take it a step further, which I'll talk about in a few minutes, of how we develop a poster presentation to really educate our peers and our faculty and our administrators on what did we actually learn at the summit, other than people think, oh yeah, you went on a great trip. Everyone's going on a trip and they're just there to have fun and roam around and not attend sessions. We require students to report back on what they've learned at the sessions and exchange business cards. So over these last years of almost, you know, 20 years close, students have had the buzz of who are their favorite ACSM presenters. And again, I don't need to go over the entire list, but I tried to put together who are the top 20 that students constantly talk about today or still talk to me on the phone in an alumni session to say, oh my gosh, is, you know, Barry Franklin still presenting? And for us, if we have an alumni connection like Barry Franklin, when we did in San Diego, then we were able to invite him to a student dinner and he could educate students about cardiac rehab in Michigan and different areas of that support, which is really nice to do. So in my our classroom settings, we like to show photos and say, if you're interested in the summit, these are some of the presenters. And I always do this in some of my courses, and I know Michelle and Chris Bopp does it as well. We talk about key individuals of why they're successful in their field. And like Len Kravitz, it was so neat this year that ACSM give you a little snippet of who's speaking for keynotes next year. I got goosebumps. I was like, oh, this is great. We're already going to know who the keynote address. And Len Kravitz is a genius when it comes to exercise physiology, and anything he presents is such high delivery. And so that will help steer students to say why they really want to attend. The most recent years, just to give you a few statistics, 2017 of San Diego, 33 students. So again, you're thinking, well, you know, when we did Long Beach, we had 75. Now, why did we drop down to 33? It could be a lot of factors. It could be the time of the year. Was it close to Easter? Was it at Penn State? Was it close to Blue-White Weekend? I mean, everything plays a significant role. Is it location of the country? Are there other opportunities that happen to fall on that same week with their academic schedule and or their, you know, if they're on an athletic team, their sports schedule? So we were pleased with 33 at San Diego. Arlington was the first new thing for us at Penn State. Because it was only less than a four-hour drive, we actually chartered a bus, which made the trip extremely affordable. It cut down on the trip hundreds of dollars. So if you just think, I'm just going to say this, State College direct to Chicago Hare, even though it's an hour and 10 minutes, our tickets were probably still $400 to $500 just for that direct little dinky flight. Some students decided to do it. Some decide other airports like Newark, and they cut down. But when it comes to a trip like Arlington, you know, we can tie that already into the course fee, and it might only cost the students $100. So they're saving $300 or $400 right from the start, which is nice. And I put 26 plus 10 because Dr. Chris Bopp in our department also took students through his outreach class and had a supportive budget as well for his 10 students. So we had a total of 36 undergraduates. In Chicago this year, we have 26, which I think is a pretty healthy number as well. It's nice to manage. And I want to note for you that we don't necessarily thrive on numbers to say we have to have 78, we have to have 32. What we simply do is we meet with the conference planner at the beginning of the year, usually towards the end of summer, around August, and we say, this is the venue site, this is the location. She knows the hotel prices are our ACSM discount. She makes some magic wizardry, Autumn Spots does this all on a computer, and will tell us, if we keep the course as is with the same things you're used to, we need to be able to have 24 students. And every year it might vary a few depending on the location of the country for Michelle and I's travel to get there and so forth. But, you know, as long as we reach the minimum, we're able to offer the course. And knock on wood, we've been doing it every year and always reach the minimum, which is nice. This is a special piece I just wanted to show and share with you. Because I mentioned to you that I do alumni development in our department for the last 3 years, I'm able to work with our alumni association and the people that I know that are our alumni and say, give us the names, or we want to offer an alumni event for our undergraduates here in Chicago and see if we have funding through the college, through our alumni association, to have a small venue meal or like social, you know, a little appetizer social. And so that goes out in a little email change, and then we find out we have 12 alums that will attend. So in San Diego, we had, I think, close to 26 to 28 alumni that were just our own people and all walks of life in the field of kinesiology graduates that wanted to meet up with our students, to network with them for jobs in the whole nine yards. And then this was one of our group class dinners where we had a few alums attend that as well. This hit social media, and it was our highest tag ever. I mean, it was over 2,000 hits within a few days just because it was tagged with ACSM, San Diego, Penn State, and then people learn, wow, I want to be involved in this, which is kind of nice. And it helps our alumni out as well because they want to be able to give back. They want to be able to tell their story and their journey of where they started and give that piece of advice so they feel connected to our university. So I want to go over the course development. So if you decide to turn this into a course, this is what we do for the pass-fail in order to maintain that 85% in the course. Number one, at the beginning of January, when our semester starts back, we meet usually about five times, five course meetings before we attend the summit. And the very first meeting is just the get to know you. Let's go over the syllabus of activities. Let's go around the room and introduce everyone. Why do you want to go to the summit? The whole nine yards. And if the program booklet is ready, because you never know if it's ready. Sometimes they don't have it uploaded quick enough. But usually in the past few years they have. Then we do program dissection. And we go by the different tracks that are being offered at the summit. Whether it's mind-body, whether it's sports management, nutrition, the whole nine yards, keynote address. And each student is required to sign up for one speaker of the whole event. And their job is to research that speaker online and or call and or Skype or Zoom or meet in person if it's available and learn information about that speaker. And we typically require that they ask questions. If you were to meet this speaker, what would you ask that individual? And usually they come up with better thoughts than Michelle and I could. We're like, that's a really nice thought. So they develop a paper, nothing too large, just maybe a three-page type summary, or handwritten. I mean, I would say it's free-flowing paragraph, so it's not a bulleted, because students like to get away with the Twitter-like feed bullets. And then they stand up in the classroom the night it's due, and they present. They stand up and say, I researched Mary Yoke, and Mary Yoke started her education, and they give us a little synopsis. So students learn and say, oh, that's interesting, and she's going to present at the conference on this topic. And did you know she was also a graduate of, did you know she was Idea Fitness Trainer of the World? So they are learning before they've even attended the conference to know strategically which sessions do they really want to go to. So that's project number one. Project number two, and I know a lot of you already probably implement this already, is they need to be able to develop a sound resume, an academically sound resume. So we go over that, we critique it peer-to-peer, we make them change it and have the most freshest copy. And one of my golden rules with anything in life, people are away from paper these days. So as much as we say bring 10 copies, they can if they want to. But when you're in that situation, and I always say this to a student, you're at O'Hare Airport, you're on a layover for two hours, you're sitting at In-N-Out Burger, eating your burger, somebody sees your badge, or you see something on them, Sony, and you ask them, do you have a Sony corporate fitness center? Oh, yes, we do. I'm not in charge of it, but my friend Bill Smith is. Would you mind if I gave you a resume or you have, yeah. If you wait until you go home, day two, day three, they don't owe you anything. There's no investment. There's no connection. But if you say to Bill Smith, what's your email address? I have my resume right here. Boom, 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 poof. Now he's more than apt to help you because you're right there in front of that person's face. So we have students bring resumes, but load them on their phone as well. But we also have them develop a sound business card, an actual professional business card, not one that's perforated. They get it professionally printed from any of those organizations online, like VistaPrint. You can get 500 for something very cheap and very economical. And they turn them in. They meet with people. They need to collect business cards. Or, you know, sometimes after a session, they'll say, hey, bring me your business card and I'll send you the slides. Students are doing that. And people are like, over the last 18 years, who are you? What do you do? You're a student and you have a business card? That points their ears. That says you have better professional development skills as an undergraduate. That gets you a little higher into that world where they may want to call you in for a second interview or email you and say, you know, I was very highly impressed with you, and now that's an extra step, an extra layer for your students. The other area is once the students are here at the conference, they're taking notes, they have their laptops, they're not doing a lot of Facebook, but they're putting together a research poster. So just like if you were going to an ACSM conference where it's all research-driven, a poster form, our students develop a poster on that tract. So if it's nutrition, we team up sometimes two or three, but usually around two students per poster. And if you're assigned to that track and you get to choose within reason, because some years students want to pick, everybody wants the one track, and we tell our students, we're signing you up for mind and body. You're only required to attend one session. Then you can attend anything else you want. So they develop this poster, and Michelle and I usually split the duty. So I usually am in charge of the assignment with the dissection and the resume and business card. And then Michelle really steers it really clear with the poster. She spends day and night and hours and a week turnaround time to help the students to make sure that that poster is professionally sound and ready for our faculty, especially when the dean shows up every year to look and ask questions. And I can tell you this for a fact. A few years back, our dean, Dean Nan Crowder, said, you know, these posters are actually better than some of the graduate posters that we've seen. And we've done videos. I've even got her on video saying this, like if we ever needed backup, you know, for support. We always make sure we have everything ready to go. And then we host a poster forum. So when students leave here tomorrow, we then have one more class where we meet and say, is the poster ready to go? And sometimes people are turning in posters right now to Michelle saying, I just want to get the first look at the poster. Tuesday, we'll do that final day, and then they go to print. And then next week, on a Wednesday, a week from Wednesday, is our poster form. So we invite all our kinesiology faculty. And if students are in other departments, biobehavioral health, we invite their faculty, we invite administrators, students to attend. Sometimes we do entice students with a few extra credit points from other classes to say, attend and write a one-page paper about what you've learned at this forum. But we also have in the operational budget money to be able to fund it with food, because when food is there, people are like, oh, Wegmans catered food. Oh my gosh, this is going to be great. And that gets them in the door. But at the end of the day, they learn something. And much more so than that, those are the students saying, what? I could have attended this. I didn't even know about it. Well, you didn't listen to your email. You didn't review it, number one. I didn't see it. Well, it was there many times. Or you did not attend kinesiology club meetings when Michelle and I showed up and said, hello, we're here. This is our last time. Who else would like to go? And so that's just a great avenue for our students to be able to voice what they've learned to their peers and to administrators and faculty. And these are some photos at the poster form. So they develop these posters. We get them printed. It's paid for by the operational budget of the course. And then we always in-house have our own easels and poster boards and the clips, because we utilize them for our internship poster form as well. In the far right, and I don't know if this is the pointer because I hate to start pointing. And yeah, right there is Dr. Dean Crowder, who just retired. She was a fabulous dean in our department, in our College of Health and Human Development. She would attend every year and not just come and say, here I am. She would go to every poster and educate and say, you know, that's nice. I didn't really see that, but this would be an opportunity for us to maybe grow here at Penn State, because she learned something at the poster forum. Our department head, Dr. Nancy Williams, right here in the center, she attends and engages with students, and sometimes the PIC from our department, Dr. Melissa Bopp, attends those sessions as well. Now let's get to the cost so you have an idea. So typically with conference registration, you have, this is where it really comes down to. This is something that we like to get in early. Now I know they're offering a discount this year. If you redo now, you save money, which is great, but you're not knowing who these students could possibly be. But if you work directly with ACSM, Don Hamilton with ACSM, you can call ACSM number, press zero, ask for Don Hamilton. She will be able to tell you if you can get a discount. Now, typically, you always get an early bird discount if you turn it in before Christmas. So we gather them as a group and mail them in as a group, because in order to get a true group discount, that's the way you have to do it. If it's only four students, they could go online to do that. But if you have more than 21 total people in your group, and that's including faculty, which we always do, in addition to the early bird discount, every person gets an additional $45 off of the ACSM registration, which is really nice. Then on top of that, if a student registers to possibly work as a student volunteer for a four-hour shift, they receive half of their tuition money back in a check. We had one student on this trip, something fell through, and they said to Bree Sturgeon, who's a student of ours, could you stay at the booth till 7 o'clock at night? We'll pay your entire fee back. She's like, yes, I will. So that was a done deal for her. Hotel, our lodging is, we stay four nights, no matter what the venue site is. We like to get her early to make sure we're here and maybe have other enriching opportunities with alumni and so forth. But it typically, since we have four students in a room, which four females, four males, in a room. And Michelle works diligently on that piece of the puzzle, and our conference planner through Penn State takes care of all of that. We don't even have to call the hotel. I got the block of rooms. You don't even need to worry about it. And we get the discount of ACSM discount. They block it early. And then the airfare, if you're flying to a location, it's plus or minus. Some students fly on frequent flyers. Some people want to fly out of their airport. It's whatever that feels the best for that student in their financial capabilities. And then we always say to students, it's food expenses. For us, with our budget, we're able to provide with the course usually one or two dinners. And so we usually do a group dinner. Years ago when we started it, the conference planner was really nice and it was really fancy. It was almost like a wedding. And I said, this is really nice, but do you think we could, whatever that costs, do you think we could just tell us what the money is? We could probably get two or three meals out of what you just spent on this. And so we like to try to manage when we know how much money do we have in the budget for food and work with it. Ways to offset the cost for students that financially can't afford a trip. What I did at the very beginning before this was a course is I had our kinesiology club purchase a small games of chance license, and we purchased this at the county just like 12 miles down the road. I can't remember the price. It might have been $60, $80, and it allows us the opportunity to have that small games of chance license to raffle something. So back in the day when Joe Paterno was alive and he was our football coach, we would raffle an autographed Joe Paterno football, and then I would get the local hotel, the Nittany Lion Inn, to donate a one-night stay, and then maybe a restaurant, two free waffles at the waffle shop. And then students would go around selling tickets, even at football games. And every ticket that you sold, it was $1 per ticket, was $1 off of your trip. So I had a student one year sell enough tickets to pay for her entire trip, and we still owed her $365. She was that savvy. She was the occupational therapist in the water photo. So that goes a long way, especially if you get donations and parents want to sell tickets. Every dollar that student sells, every ticket, is $1 off of their trip. So if they only want to sell 100 tickets, that's still $100, which is pretty decent for a student. On our campus, we have something called the UPAC. It's University Allocation Funds. Now, early on, because we were not a course, we could apply for funding, or students could apply for funding and get their course funded. So there was a year, I will not lie, where the entire trip for 14 students was fully funded through Penn State Allocation Committee. Now, those students have to present and speak upon a board. It's a tedious process, but here's how I operated it. You had to be in either way. You couldn't say, hey, we had the money, now I want to join the trip. It was, are you in, whether you get the funding or not? And yes, these 14 people committed either way. Then you suddenly had money. But the caveat to that UPAC funding is, if it's part of a course curriculum, you cannot receive the funding for that trip. So we don't necessarily go for UPAC funding, and we don't need to utilize that and tap that strength anymore. I also mentioned here, like I said, kinesiology club members, students will work through their kinesiology club. They can, and they've worked at events like venue sites, men and women's basketball games where they're selling, you know, pizzas and hot dogs and sodas. If they work as a club and they can guarantee 10 students will be there to work that venue site, a certain portion of the profits go back to the club, and then they divide it out, they tease out the data. You've worked so many hours and we're giving you X, so that's money off of your trip. That could be a possibility for you. And then we usually tell students, once they know, they typically, in the fall, Michelle and I will go to the very first kinesiology club meeting right after Labor Day. That's where we start the marketing. Here's the trip, who could be interested? Sign this. Michelle develops a list, sends out a listserv, we have a meeting, and then we tease it down of what students are really interested at that point. And then we tell students, you know, if you're considering flying to that location site, this is the time when it's around the holidays, whether you celebrate Kwanzaa or Hanukkah or Christmas or none of it or all of it, that this is the time when grandma says, what would you like for Christmas? I was wondering if I could have $50 to offset the cost of my plane ticket. You know, so sometimes students are willing to get that type of support from family members. Or they work. We have students that have host full-time jobs while they're in school, and that's what they do. They're driven to say, I'm going to work extra hours as a nursing assistant to be able to afford this trip, and I'm going. I'm in. Like I said, we had the student volunteer program, so students can get half off that tuition. But I always tell students it's not a guarantee. ACSM picks a handful, and it's not going to be all Penn State. It might be three. We're not sure. It depends on how many students really want to do that, but there's the possibility. So our course operational budgets will include some of the following. One, we have a group etiquette dinner. And so this year, the group dinner was at Giordano's down the street, and I booked that, I don't know, a month ago or 6 weeks in advance. And we work within that budget and say, this is what we're doing. Or if we want to do pizzas in the hotel, whatever we can put forth. And we also like I said in the past, we like to invite a few alumni. So if it's an alumni speaking at the conference, or somebody that's associated with Penn State, or even if it's not, a student comes up to us in the hallway and said, you're not going to believe this. I just talked to June Kahn, and she just loves Penn State. And she's invite her to tonight's dinner if you'd like. I can do that. Yes, we have a few extra spots. And there they get to do this extra little connection on the side, which is nice. And so our operational budget also includes poster form supplies, like the posters, the poster form catering. Sometimes we need Subway tokens. We have 10 minutes. Is that what you're showing me? Okay. Just want to make sure, because I want to show you this video at the end. Sometimes, like in San Diego, we had to sub them in or take the train, so we had money in the operational budget for that. We took a chartered bus once in San Diego. Cedric Bryant, Dr. Cedric Bryant, is an alum of ours. He's the chief operational advisor to ACE. And so we got a private tour behind the scenes. We took a chartered bus there. So that came out of our budget. And if it didn't, and we felt it was really imperative, we could also go to the department head, and or we'd go to the department head first, and if the department head said, no, we don't have that, possibly the college might have money, then we might be able to steer some other funding to be able to make that happen. So quickly, I want to go over university-based course schematics. Now, this could be different for every academic institution, but this is the way we operated at Penn State. So because this is a course curriculum, they're taking academic credits, 2 credits pass-fail. Michelle and I do not operate the budget. It's a magic wizardry. We just know they tell us, this is what you're able to work with for X, Y, and Z. So there's money associated with every credit. And so they know what the operational budget looks like. So the things that are bolded here in hot pink have to happen in order for the course to run. So for the course management, which is called conferences and institutes at Penn State, they call it CNI, they are the people that help deliver our operational budget. So they are the manpower for these extra things. And so a fee is associated with them for doing so. So we have to make sure that we have enough students that participate so that they are paid for their operational budget. We have a budget. And then Michelle and I don't say, hey, I hope there's extra money. Or we don't know until the end of the year, like May or June, was there leftover money? There could have been. And if so, the college gets a cut of it. And then the department gets a cut. What's that percentage? I do not know. We don't know what that is. But sometimes there is extra money. Like I can guarantee the year we went to Vegas or California with 78 students, we had a surplus. It probably went back into undergraduate educational support. So it wasn't like it went into somebody else's pocket. It stayed within the correct domains. So in order to complete a new course proposal, these are things that we've worked towards and things that you might consider. Number one, you could discuss that eagerness with your department head, that you want to steer a trip or bring students, maybe not necessarily the course right away, but a trip, an engagement opportunity. Then you might further develop it into a syllabus mode with learning outcomes. What are they actually going to learn in the process? And then seek that support from your department and or your college. And then, and Michelle Duffy's on Faculty Senate. Faculty Senate has to approve it at the end of the day. So timeline to promote the course. We visit the clubs in the fall after Labor Day. We host informational meetings. We then collect around Thanksgiving before Christmas winter break, the registration forms. We do email blast. We have the 5 meetings and then the 2 class meetings post. And these are just some things that have evolved over the years. Food expenses, experiential learning trips, invited speakers to attend our dinner, roundtable discussions. If we've seen there's extra space and we know that someone's here, could we host a little quick thing in the hallway? It's pretty much real organic in nature. We didn't plan on it, but now it happens. Somebody invites us to Equinox as a class. Are we going to do it? Yes, we're going to take advantage of that. So then we also host alumni engagement as well. So I just show you this real quick before I go through the video because I want to get you out of here on time. We post all the time. So this was Reno 2003 of some of the students, and Heather Jackson, who attended like 3 years in a row, she said, I came across this while cleaning out my desk, and I believe this was 15 years ago. And then Mark Werner said that was the best trip he ever took. That's where he met his wife on the trip. And she wants to, and the wife responds, I want to have a reunion. What do you guys think? So it's constant. So anytime we post, every student that we've ever attended, if they're part of social media, beyond thumbs up. They're like, hey, this is exciting. And it's just a great network and a great system. This is a student that's going to graduate this year for Long Beach, California, exceptional student, Levi Reniger. And I asked him in San Diego, would you develop a video? Because he's very good at that. And he chose to do so. And I want to see if this will open for you, because this is really nice. I don't know how to turn this down. Do you know how to turn this down?
Jesus, yeah. We call that child of God. or something, and it kicked my butt.
My favorite lecture was staying tuned. What should I eat when I'm hungry?
Hungry, what should I eat? Because I think it's a huge problem in our country. We're really disconnected about our nutrition.
The workplace wellness one, I learned a lot in regards to how you implement being active while you're at a full-time job, you're really busy, you might have kids, you might have family, multiple things to be going on, but you can still stay active throughout the day.
Gives you a little idea of how it's really surfaced into something larger than we expected. I didn't think it would ever get to this level. I just thought a few people, it's getting bigger, bigger, bigger. I don't know what that is. Okay. I thought it was getting bigger and bigger, and it just really has taken off to a great fold. I would stick around and answer any questions you have. We have some swag to give away. I don't know how much we have. I know Michelle Duffy has a few t-shirts. I have a few t-shirts, a coffee mug, frisbees. I don't know. If you want something, come on up and I'll get you a treat. But thank you so much for listening. We're willing to help you. If you want to stick around and we can answer any questions for you or get you on the right path or teach you something that could help steer this to next year, we really want to try to really get some more student involvement next year. Again, it's just, I say four students. Why? Because if you get four of the same domain, whether it's four males or females, it will cut down on the cost for that hotel room. So thank you so much. Thank you to ACSM for allowing us to provide this support of what we do at Penn State University. We are
Penn State.
Thank you.